Let's say you're able to consistently hit a golf ball at 50 meters per second at a 45 degree angle. This sends your ball about 100 meters down the fairway. You swing again and hit a ball exactly the same way, but right as you do, a big gust of wind comes along. It blows perfectly perpendicular to the fairway at 10 meters per second. Where will the ball land? Well, the intuitive answer might be that the ball goes the same distance, but it will be blown to the side by some amount. However, if we run this through a simulation, we find out that the ball doesn't go the same distance. It actually travels slightly less than 100 meters. I made this simulation a year ago for my aircraft dynamics class, and thankfully I didn't make it wrong. This is the correct answer. But don't worry if this isn't what you expected. It surprised me too. In fact, almost half of the students in the class got the problem wrong despite writing their own simulations. How did so many third-year aerospace engineering students get it wrong? Well, let's start with the basic drag equation, which is sort of becoming a theme on this channel. Drag is equal to your coefficient of drag times your dynamic pressure times your area. Dynamic pressure consists of 1/2 the air density times the velocity squared. Let's ignore most of those numbers because they're constant, and let's just look at your velocity squared. Traveling in one direction is a very simple calculation, but the errors start to appear when the ball is traveling in 2D or 3D. These more complex motions require a velocity in a vector form rather than a single value. For example, in 2D you would have an x velocity and a y velocity. It seems reasonable to just calculate the drag in each direction using that component of velocity. In this case, we would have an x drag and a y drag. But you could also find the magnitude of the total velocity using the Pythagorean theorem and turn it back into a one-dimensional problem. The issue is that when we try both of these methods, we actually get different results. If we use a velocity of 10 meters per second in both directions, for example, the first method gives us 141.42 something times our constant, but the second method gives us 200 times our constant. We know that that second method is correct, because it's the same as rotating our coordinate frame to match the velocity vector and turning this into a one-dimensional problem. So the real question is, why does the component method give us less drag? Well, it actually has to do with the fact that we're squaring velocity. The square function is not linear. Doubling the input will quadruple the output, and the same is true in reverse. If we have the input, we quarter the output. Imagine we have a one-dimensional velocity again, equal to 10 meters per second. If we square that, we get 100. But if we split it into two components of 5 meters per second each, and we square those, we get two values of 25, which sum to 50. That's not the same answer. Clearly, you can't break a velocity into separate components if you're going to square it. Now, in the golf ball example, it wasn't quite as simple as splitting it in half because we're using the Pythagorean theorem, but hopefully you can see how the same logic applies. This also explains why crosswind affects the distance traveled down the fairway. This wind increases the total velocity of the ball through the air, increasing drag in all three dimensions, even the ones perpendicular to the original wind. The students that got this problem wrong were using the component method without realizing this was an issue. There was two ways this happened. Some students explicitly used components like this, but others tried to take a shortcut and may not have realized what they were doing. In MATLAB, you can write the drag equation like this, but in our case, it will give us an error because you're trying to square a vector, which is impossible. So it will recommend that you add a period in front of the exponent like this. What that's doing is telling MATLAB to square the components of the vector, rather than the entire vector. So this looks just like the drag equation and seems fine at first glance, but it's reintroducing that error that we were just talking about. What the students were trying to do was skip the step of calculating the magnitude of the drag and then breaking it into its components. They were trying to use the vector form of velocity to get a drag vector out all in one line. When testing, they would still see an initial drag vector in the correct direction because the ball is moving at exactly 45 degrees. This means that the error is equal in both the x and y directions, but the total magnitude would still be wrong, and the angle would also be wrong if the velocity angle was anywhere between 0 or 45. But as the problem was written, they probably wouldn't have noticed the error. Now, it is possible to get a drag vector in a single line, in fact that's what I did in my code, but it is written slightly differently. Instead of adding the period, you split the velocity square term into two separate velocities. Then you take the magnitude of one, using the norm function in MATLAB, and you multiply them. This multiplies a velocity vector by the scalar magnitude of that velocity, which is the same as squaring the magnitude and then breaking it into its components. Combined with the rest of the drag equation, this gives you the exact same drag vector that you would get if you were to calculate the magnitude of drag all on its own, and then multiply it by the negative of your heading vector. In other words, this is a more efficient way to calculate the drag, but you need to be careful. Now, you may still be struggling with the original problem, where a crosswind decreased the distance down the fairway. But fortunately for you, I have another example. Let's replace the golf ball with a plane flying straight down a runway. With no wind, it just points forward and moves in a straight line. But now let's say the wind is equal but perpendicular to the speed of travel. In other words, the plane still moves forward at the same velocity, but the wind is blowing it to the right at an equal velocity. To travel in a straight line, the plane has to fly at a 45 degree angle into the wind. This is because the velocity relative to the ground is equal to the velocity relative to the air plus the velocity of the wind, which is represented graphically by this vector sum. Now, which of these cases requires more fuel to travel the same distance? Well, it should be pretty intuitive that fighting a crosswind requires extra fuel. If we look at the path the airplane takes through the air and compare it to the one it took over the ground, we see that while it's traveled the same distance in the real world, the plane will feel like it's flown a much longer distance diagonally through the air. This extra length represents the extra fuel that the plane has to burn. Now we can look at the golf ball the same way. The distance traveled is proportional to the power produced by the player, and a crosswind will waste some of that power the same way that it wasted fuel for the plane. Of course, the opposite is true if there's a tailwind, which would save fuel for the plane and increase the distance the ball travels, and a headwind, of course, would hurt both of them, making them travel through more air before they can cover the same distance, or in the case of the ball, the same amount of air but less physical distance. Anyway, hopefully one of those explanations worked for you. If you want to learn more about aerodynamics and aerospace, check out my channel, including my recent video on the area rule. But for now, I'm Con Hathi, and I'll see you in the next video.